Hello and welcome back to Whitelands Football and welcome back to another podcast episode. Lewis here today. I'm here on my own. I'm not joined by anyone today because it's very late. It's 1 a.m. I'm very hot in my room, but here we are for another episode. Now, we've got a few things to talk about today. We're going to be talking about Cristiano Ronaldo's tax investigation. If you've not been hide under a rock, you will know about that situation. So we'll go into a bit of detail on that. We're going to be talking about Mohamed Salah's transfer to Liverpool, how that's going to work out and how that's going to help Jurgen Klopp and the Reds. We're going to be talking a little about the rule changes in football that have been proposed, give my views on that. And we're also going to be talking a little bit about Cody McDonald as a Gillingham legend leaves the club. Obviously, Gillingham fan myself, and I know a lot of the followers are Gillingham fans as well. Before we go on to answer a few questions off of Twitter. Now, I'm going to start off talking about Cristiano Ronaldo. Now, this is a big thing because he's one of the best players in the world, arguably the best player in the world. I think Messi's better, but to some, Ronaldo is the best player in the world, arguably the greatest ever. And he joins a club of players, not a club you want to be in, of players that have been accused and sentenced of tax fraud. Normally in Spain, joins the likes of Mascherano, Messi, Di Maria, of evading tax. Now, there are four charges of tax fraud in total. It adds up to 14.7 million euros, obviously, euros they use in Spain, and this is 12.95 million pounds. So just to put that in a bit of context, obviously, that is an awful lot of money, even for a footballer. These break down into 1.4 million pounds in 2011, 1.6 million pounds in 2012, 3.2 million pounds in 2013. I actually mean euros, I've just seen that, 8.5 million euros in 2014. Now, that is an awful lot of money that he has obviously avoided. And that's not what you want to see. I mean, a lot of people in the Messi versus Ronaldo battle saying, oh, Messi might be better, but at least Ronaldo pays his taxes. Now, that argument can't be used anymore because Ronaldo has, of course, reportedly not paid his taxes. Now, rumour has it that he's used a complicated series of offshore companies to receive millions paid from sponsors for his image rights. Now, he's basically been very clever to avoid having to pay these taxes, as reported. Some might question why, what's the point? Obviously, he's one of the richest, I suppose you could say, people in the world. The sort of wages he's on is silly money. Everyone else can pay their tax, why can't he, sort of thing. I don't think he's going to have too much problem getting out of it, though, because obviously there are rumours if he could face the prison sentence. We know that in the modern day, footballers can easily pay their way out of prison sentences, as we have seen with Lionel Messi. Now, he's to give a testimony on July the 31st in Madrid, obviously where he's based, playing for Real Madrid, and where, sort of in Spain, he's being accused of this. He is a suspect, and the judge will then decide if he goes to trial, if the case goes to trial after the statement is given by Cristiano Ronaldo. Sentences under 2 years are normally suspended, as we saw with Messi's sentence, which was 21 months, just under 2 years, as has been seen with Di Maria's sentence recently as well. But they're basically suspended, which means they won't happen immediately. That's not too big a deal, because although prison might sound like a big deal, it's good for headlines of the papers, it doesn't normally happen. On top of that, he's going to face a fine of 28 million euros, which is, I suppose, 2 years, probably under 2 years' wages for Ronaldo. Ronaldo can quarter the minimum sentence for each charge, so overall quarter the whole charge, I guess, if he pays back the money within 2 months. So he's basically got to pay back 14.7 million euros on top of the fine. So that's about 32 million euros that he's got to pay back in 2 months. Now, I'm sure he has the money, but that is going to still be a big damage to his bank account nonetheless. Now, as I mentioned, he joins the club with the likes of Mascherano, Messi, Di Maria, also while playing in Spain. It seems like a big thing that happens to players whilst they're playing in Spain. Now, Mascherano and Messi, both Barcelona, Di Maria's was whilst he was at Real Madrid, and Ronaldo's obviously also while he's at Real Madrid. A big stat that I found off of the independent website was that Messi turned a 21-month sentence, so of course just under 2 years, into a 250,000 euro fine, which is probably a week's wages, even less than that for Messi. So that probably wasn't too big a deal, and that's basically simply paying your way out of the sentence, which I'm sure Ronaldo will also do. Now, I don't necessarily think that's fair, because if you've committed the crime, then you should serve your time. I mean, I know obviously people can afford it, but why is being rich allow you to that to happen? And if that was a sort of thing, I feel like the fine you have to pay to sort of eliminate that sentence should be representative of what you earn. So a week's wages for Messi, which he had to pay, isn't exactly ideal in terms of the fairness of it, if you like, because that's not going to do much damage to him, and he's basically just saved himself 2 years in jail, which I'm sure many people would like to do. But basically, Ronaldo is going to give a testimony, going to face a trial, and going to see what happened. But nevertheless, that does give a big damage to Ronaldo's reputation. And more importantly, from a footballing point of view, there are rumours that he is on his way out of Real Madrid, and he has told the club that he wants to leave. Now, there are some people saying that he does this to get a new contract. I mean, he's on plenty of money already, but, you know, got to pay those fraud fines. So maybe he wants a bit more. But nevertheless, it does sort of seem that he wants out because of the way he's been treated. I'm assuming he's maintaining his innocence in this whole situation, but he wants out because of the way he's treated in Spain. The main rumour, as Sky sources are reporting, is that Manchester United are interested, and he's interested in going back to Manchester United. Now, we know that he played here before. I think his role in terms of position was very important. When he was at Manchester United before, he was sort of a right midfielder. Obviously, had that cracking season, 40-plus goals in the league, which was insane. Transitioned into a left wing, assumably to, you know, as most wingers did, sort of cut in onto their stronger foot, hit those screamers, which he has obviously done many, many times. So, looking at Manchester United, I mentioned how he turned into a left winger. More of a striker. Now he's obviously 33 years old. He's losing that bit of pace about him. He's obviously got that brilliant finishing. Sticks the ball in the net. Would Manchester United want to get him to play up front? I sort of always look at the price. Obviously, he's a quality player. Went for a world record fee at the time. Obviously, now it is held by Manchester United for Paul Pogba, which £89 million. Now, there's no doubt in my mind that would be smashed because of his talent. But, you know, 100 million plus maybe for a striker that you're going to get maybe 3 years out of the top of your game. Is that what you're looking for? I've seen people say that Manchester United should put that sort of money in for Harry Kane instead of Ronaldo. I mean, personally, I don't see why Kane would move down there anyway, but I see that as more of an ideal thing because Kane's a lot younger. You're going to get 10, even maybe more years out of him. Guaranteed success, proven in the league. I mean, obviously, Ronaldo is as well, and his quality, but, you know, you're paying more money for an older player. It'd be a big dent in their budget. I mean, there's no doubt they've got the money, but is that the sort of money you're going to want to splash, or you can also spend it on other areas of the team? For me, Ibra has just moved away from Manchester United, which means that they are sort of allowing more focus to turn to the likes of Paul Pogba, Marcus Rashford, Martial, lesser focus on Ibra, who's up front, who's older, but you know he's got the quality, he's got the legacy, and that's what they're focusing on. So, in a way, that's a good thing for Manchester United. I mean, I spoke about that in a previous podcast, but do they want to take a sort of back step and maybe an upgrade to Ronaldo, but do they want to stay on that focus of him just because of purely who he is, or do they want to look to spend their money elsewhere? I mean, if they bought in Kane, they could sort of build their team around him, Pogba, Kane, rather than just the old player because of his quality, if you get what I'm saying. But I'm sure United fans would welcome him. I'm sure United probably would welcome him. I mean, he'd welcome it. It does seem like the most plausible option for me if he is to leave Real Madrid. Now, other rumoured clubs are PSG. Obviously, they've got the money. I'm sure he'd do absolutely brilliantly up front in the French league. We've seen that of Ibrahimovic. We've seen that of other players, especially with Ronaldo's track record. I mean, would he want to conquer another league? It'd help PSG out massively. They've got the money. Obviously, it's away from Spain, so Ronaldo would probably be interested. But, you know, I think it would lose a lot of focus on Ronaldo because of the quality of that league, where we see defenders struggle, where it doesn't necessarily represent how good you are a player because of the other teams in the league. But that would help PSG in the Champions League. So I'll say, other than Manchester United, PSG is the most likely option because of the sort of money they have. Do they have the gap with Cavani? Probably. I mean, it's not like anyone's going to keep Ronaldo out of the team, but they sort of saw when Ibrahimovic was there that, you know, Cavani pushed out wide. That's not what they want. They want Cavani to be their main man, but I'm sure they'd welcome him because of his class. It's that sort of thing, you know. United and PSG, maybe he's not best fit for them, but they welcome him because of who he is, the class. So If he wants to go away, that's fine. But maybe it's not best for those clubs. I mean, obviously you're looking at China, where they can spend the money. I mean, does he want to call the end, inverted commas, on his career? Go to China, pick up a nice wage, you know. Definitely coming towards the end of his career if he goes there. But, you know, pick up the wages. They can afford him. That's what he'll want to do. You know, Statman Dave suggested Barcelona. Imagine what that would be. Probably, you know, playing on the right, playing on the left. You know, Neymar on one, Ronaldo on the other, Suarez up front and Messi behind them. Imagine what that would be. But obviously highly unlikely because of that Barcelona-Real Madrid link. And that would probably be La Liga suicide for Real Madrid. Maybe even Champions League suicide. The two best players in the world playing at the same club. So what's he worth? I mean, obviously I spoke about them smashing the transfer record wherever he goes. That's 89 million for Paul Pogba. Is he worth more than that 80 million he costs at the time now? I mean, he's obviously much more proven. He's got four Ballon d'Ors under his belt, probably on for a fifth. His age is a big factor now. I think he joined Real Madrid in 2008. That's 9 years ago. He's 24 now. He's 33. I mean, he's got 3 years in him. I don't personally think, I mean, I know the market's more inflated now, but I don't personally think, I mean, I definitely know I wouldn't want my clubs to be, if I was the owner of a club, I wouldn't want my club to be paying that much for a player going to get 3 years out of, no matter how good he is, no matter how much he means to the club, such as Manchester United. I wouldn't want my club to be playing that sort of price. So, I mean, 50 million maybe? I mean, I know it's going to be ridiculous. That's the sort of money I'd be willing to spend maximum because of his quality, but you're not going to get much out of him. Obviously, he'd be a large dent in the wage department as well. But I think personally he could go for whatever. He could go for 140 million, he could go for anything because of his quality, because of the money clubs have to spend, such as Manchester United, such as PSG. And I think personally, I think he'll get a new deal at Real Madrid. He'll sort out the tax thing. He will pay it off. He'll pay the fine just like Messi did. He'll stay at Madrid. But you know, as a neutral point of view, it would be very good to see him back in the Premier League. But we will obviously see where he ends up. So, the second topic we're going to go on to talk about is Mohamed Salah and his move to Liverpool, which has been confirmed in the last week. Now, I just want to clear a few things up. And I uploaded a video that has now been removed where I said I was a Liverpool follower as well as Gillingham. Now, I just want to clear a few things up. When I was younger, I wasn't really into football. And when I hit about maybe 7, 8, I got into football. Easiest thing to watch was the Premier League. So I looked at the back page of a newspaper, saw some league tables. Points Liverpool. They're my favourite team, I said. Third in the Premier League at the time they were. So I turned to the Championship and I was like, oh, Dad, they're higher than us. You know, Championship, that's a whole different league. So it's not like I was Glory Hunter or anything. Dad says, no, obviously the Championship's lower than the Premier League. So I basically grew up following Liverpool. I didn't really know much about football. At the same time, my first football match was a Gillingham match in 2007. Gillingham lost 2-1 against Port Vale. And I've obviously always followed my local team. I always followed Liverpool and Gillingham. And then I was sort of went to Gillingham on and off growing up. And then since about 2012, I've been going to Gillingham regularly. I mean, a couple of players came into school to talk to us. It was Charlie Allen and Ben Strevens. And I sort of thought, you know, I've got to get a bit of this. And I went to Gillingham regularly. I fell in love with the club. I've been very passionate about Gillingham. I've done stuff at the club. I've been away. I've been home. You know, I still keep up to date on Liverpool in the Premier League because that's what I knew in my childhood. But I just wanted to clear that up because I'm obviously a very, very passionate Gillingham fan. If they played each other, I'd love Gillingham to win every day of the week. But in terms of a favourite Premier League team, if you like, it's Liverpool. I just wanted to clear that up. Just a few things there. So basically, I'm going to talk about Mohamed Salah's transfer now from Roma to Liverpool. 42 million euros. Now, that is not cheap money. He's been proven in Serie A. 34 goals and 83 appearances for Roma, which is cracking return for a winger, despite, you know, the lower standard of Serie A. He's got the goals, but the thing that sticks out for me is obviously he was in the league before. He was at Chelsea and he struggled. Now, he's come out himself and said he's matured a lot more as he's got older. He said that he's a lot better now, got a more understanding of the game. And to be fair, I can respect that. I mean, he's looked very good at Roma. He was disappointed at Chelsea for sure, but at Roma, he's just improved so much. He's such a Jurgen Klopp type of player. He's fast, he's skillful, he's got that work rate. He's expensive, of course. I mean, I've heard of Ball Street, actually, an interview that Liverpool have £150 million to spend plus any money they get in from player transfers this summer. So that's 42 million euros. I'm not sure exactly what the conversion rate is, but, you know, mid to high 30s in terms of million pounds. So that's a big chunk of that gone already. I mean, We was obviously talking about the squad depth of Liverpool last season. I mentioned Harry Wilson and Ben Woodburn constantly being on the bench. Like, I don't think Harry Wilson was, but Ben Woodburn for sure, constantly on the bench last season. And now, of course, Liverpool in the Champions League, that's more games to play, which means you need a thicker squad. And I think Liverpool did excellently to get top four on that thin squad anyway. So it's good they've got him in. But the price they've sort of bought him for, is he going to play every week? I mean, he likes to play on the right, left-footed player to cut in. Sadio Mane likes to play on the right. Now, if Jurgen Klopp wants to stick to his 4-3-3 that he's playing, I'm just sort of wondering where they're going to fit in. I mean, Coutinho was obviously playing a lot deeper last season. Towards the end of last season, he was playing deeper in a diamond formation. But this season, if you're going to play Coutinho deeper in the 4-3-3, that means either Sadio Mane or Salah have got to move out to the left. Would that be Mane to cut him? Would that be Salah just to play on his left side? Now, I think it depends on whether you want to shift Mane after a successful first season or if you just think one of them is better on the right side. But I think both are going to play because of the money they cost and the talent they both have. Now, if I was in Jurgen Klopp's shoes, I would be playing that 4-3-3. I'd be playing, obviously, the four defenders, which I'm not going to go into in this podcast because I think it's incredibly weak. But in terms of midfield, I'd play Jordan Henderson, Holding, Coutinho and Lallana deeper, and then I'd play Mane on the left to cut in, Salah on the right behind. I'm going to say Firmino because of how he works in Klopp's system. But there's a lot of debate of whether Liverpool should have been spending that sort of money on a right winger. Maybe they should have been looking at left winger to play Coutinho deeper, plays in the more natural positions. But yeah, because of his price, I think he's going to be playing often. I think it's cracking to see him back in Premier League. He's got good for him to get another shot. He's not exactly old. So, you know, he's got a lot of chance to prove himself in the Champions League as well at Liverpool. I'm interested to see what he can do. See if he's learned from his experience at Chelsea. He obviously knows the league and see if he can do it better. So Liverpool obviously have added to the strength of their squad in depth, which is a good deal. You know, it's interesting to see what else they bring in. I think they need a keeper. I know they're not going to. Jurgen Klopp said he's happy with his goalkeeper options. Simon Mignolet, end of the season strongly. Looks like he's going to keep the number one jersey for next season. Not obviously literally because Carrier's the number one, but metaphorically he'll be the number one. I think they definitely need a left back because, you know, James Milner, 32 or thereabouts years of age. Is he going to play every week? You know, not a natural left back. Definitely something they need. Moreno not good enough. Definitely need a centre back, I feel. Obviously they're in for Van Dijk. That obviously went a bit, you know, tits up, which we did cover in the last podcast. Check that out too. It'd be nice to get a decent centre back in to partner Joel Matip there, to see them two play together. I mean, I've mentioned Koulibaly before, who was linked with Chelsea. Stefan de Vrij has been linked as well, I know that. So I definitely need to shore up that defence. I'm not going to go into detail. That might be something for a Lewis's Lounge episode, but I think I definitely need to shore up that defence because it was incredibly weak, and it's sort of what cost them maybe finishing any higher up next season, last season. I mean, I know they came up against weaker teams and struggled, but that defence obviously wasn't great, and you know they've had a defensive problems for a while since Brendan Rodgers was in charge, and they just missed out of the league because of their defensive record. But I think that they definitely need to improve that defence if they're going to challenge higher this season. Now, I think they need a left winger. That's purely because I know they've bought Salah in, and either him or Mane are going to probably play on the left, but I think that they need a left winger to play there naturally if needed. Coutinho is going to play deeper, which means they need someone to play on that left rather than Coutinho. I mean, I know Nico Morales has said that a lot. We had a conversation on Twitter about it. They need that left winger so Coutinho could play deeper and someone in their natural position. But you know, that might not be looked at now because they've got Salah or Mane that could play on the left. Coutinho can obviously still play there if necessary. And also, I've got written down that they need a striker to stick the ball in the net. I mean, Sturridge, I think Klopp likes him, would like to have him around, but he's not a starter. Firmino is that more defensive forward that likes to press the back line, win the ball back, play on the counter attack. And there are obviously questions whether Divock Origi is good enough. Maybe not yet, but we'll see in the future. I mean, if Liverpool do play the 4-3-3, like I've already said, I think Salah and Mane will play on the left. If not, and they play the diamond, then I can't predict exactly. I think they'll only be playing certain situations. You know, maybe Salah will play behind the striker, maybe Mane behind the striker. You know, but that's up for Jurgen Klopp to decide. But it's definitely nice for him to have more options. So now I'm going to go on to talk about some rule changes that have been proposed by the game. Again, you know, let's mess with something that is so popular and so great and loved by so many people, because that's how the world works. They like to fix things that aren't broken, which happens a lot in education as well. But there you go. A couple of the rules, a few of the rules covered, I'm going to go through. First of all, the most dominant rule, I think, is they're going to be talking about 60-minute games with 30-minute halves. Now, this is supposed to increase the length of the game because of time wasting, and talk about stopping the clock whenever the ball goes out of play. So, you know, if substitutions being made, if it's out for a corner or a goal kick, stop time wasting, and eventually it is supposed to lengthen the game time. I'm not sure how it's going to work, but, you know, if I'm going to a football match, I'd rather watch 90 minutes rather than 60 minutes. I'm not about the stopping the clock. I think time wasting is part of the game. I mean, as much as how much you hate it, when your team's doing it, you love it. When you're live at a game and you're 2-1 up and your team's time wasting a bit, tactically, you know, a bit of gamesmanship. 30 minutes halves, I mean, it just feels like less. I mean, why do you want to make something so great shorter? I mean, I know it's not supposed to make it shorter, but from my point of view, you're making it shorter, and I just think it's completely unnecessary because you've got the 245 minutes, which is fine. It's what the game's grown up in. It's going to affect how teams play. I mean, I've heard Lawrence talk about this in the front three, because it's going to affect how teams play, because certain teams set up their teams to play on the counter-attack for 90 minutes, or pound the ball at a certain point, change the point of your attack, or change your style or tactics. It's going to have to be completely re-evaluated. I just think it's pointless, but I don't think it'll happen personally. Another one that's made up is players can pass themselves from goal kicks or free kicks or corners, which is again stupid, because it'll just define, like, get rid of the point of walls in free kicks. It will get rid of the point of corners, because it'll just be like normal crosses. People can just take the corner from where they want effectively. It's interesting to know how it affects the distance you can have. It's like playing on, it's not even much point in a free kick. And I just think set pieces is such a big part of the game. So many teams pride themselves on their set pieces, and I think it's just editing it too much. It's a bit of an unnecessary rule change. Something that comes into that is that you can take a free kick when the ball's moving. Where do you take the free kick from? If the ball's moving, do you take it from where it is, or how long do you let the ball move for before you kick it? And is there any point in a free kick? It's just like, it's like rugby effectively. Obviously it'll keep the flow of the game going, but I just think it's so pointless, and all the set pieces that sort of teams plan out is going to have to be reevaluated. The coaching style is going to have to be changed. I know it happens a lot in football, but it's part of it, isn't it? It's part of the controversy we love. It's just ruining the game. No rebounds from penalties, I think. It's supposed to stop people intruding the penalty area, so I suppose that's basically like someone takes a penalty, they even miss it, they score it. But you know, it's always nice, because you know that if your team misses a penalty, they've always got the chance to get the rebound. Take out moments like the playoff semi-final a few years ago in the championship between Watford and Leicester. I mean, Leicester missed the penalty and Watford ran up over and scored. You're not going to have moments like that. And it would just disrupt the flow of the game. I mean, I know I spoke about that in terms of the ball moving, but it just disrupt the flow of the game, and it's just what you're used to, and there's just no need to change it. If you're the defensive team as well, and your keeper saves a penalty, you're up for the double save or the rebound, or it's just an exciting part that, you know, I don't necessarily think needs to be changed. One rule that I don't think is so bad is that they want to blow for full time or half time only when the ball is out of play. Now, I know this could sound ridiculous, because it could extend the games, so say the ball could just stay in play for ages, but it's sort of like rugby as well. I think it would be interesting to introduce the idea of players just booting the ball into the crowd, like, and celebrating like they do in rugby, which I think is a great scene to watch. I think it's fair enough, because it would get rid of the idea of blowing the whistle at the wrong time. It'd probably get rid of the idea of, you know, the controversy of whether you should let the team take the corner if they get a corner. Is it an opportunity to score? Because obviously referees don't like to blow their whistle at those point in times. The ball could stay in play for a long time, which could just defy the point of extra time. You know, if there's 7 minutes extra time and the ball player stays in play for 9 minutes and they score, is that sort of what you want? Because you don't know how long you're actually playing for. So I think it'd be interesting. But in summary, basically, those are only a few of the rules. I'm just giving my immediate reactions. But overall, I don't think the game needs to be changed. There's nothing wrong with it. It's a game that so many have fallen in love with over the years. Such a long-winding game. I mean, I know obviously you've got to tip up the rules every now and again, but such drastic changes to things that aren't necessarily broken, I think it's just ridiculous. But to be honest, I don't think they'll come into play anyway, so I don't think we have too much to worry about. So the final thing we're going to discuss today is the situation with Cody McDonald, who has officially left Gillingham Football Club. He's had three stints at the club, you know, most recently obviously ending in this window. He's out of contract. He signed for AFC Wimbledon, basically, if you're not sure. He's rumoured to go there before. I know Neil Ardley was in contact with him, and he nearly signed there before, and he's been in talks to him for a long time, but he's turned down a new deal. Nick Ball has tweeted out saying that Wimbledon offered him terms similar to his contract at Gillingham last year, which means Gillingham probably gave him a lot worse terms. I was listening to the Last Waltz blog podcast, shout out to them. James Hawkins said that Tom Eaves, who's the new signing in, is worthy of a 2-year contract and McDonald's not. I mean, obviously it's not official, but it sounds like McDonald's offered a 1-year contract on worse terms. And he said in his own interview, McDonald, that he thought he's going to end his career at Gillingham, which is quite sad because I'd have loved him to. I'm sure loads of Gillingham fans would have loved him to. There's rumours that Adrian Pennock didn't fancy him anyway, you know, long ball, as we sort of sadly moulded into that sort of side under Adrian Pennock. I'm just going to quote Gilles in the Blood here because he creates his own video. I'll leave a link to that in the description. But he obviously gave his thoughts on Cody McDonald's departure, and I got a lot of stats off there. But reportedly, Cody McDonald said himself that he's sort of had to adapt his own game last season, Gillingham playing up front in his own. That's a new role at 30 years of age. Is that what you want? It's kind of ironic that we signed a target man on the day that McDonald leaves, as McDonald works well with target men. But there we go. I'm hoping, you know, I've seen a lot of journalists saying that we've replaced McDonald with a target man. We haven't. That target man's brought in. I'm hoping to work with a quick goal scoring striker that we're going to get in the future, hopefully. McDonald's stats. So the club has been around for 124 years and McDonald leaves with our 9th highest goal scorer. Now, if you ask me, no matter what you think of Cody McDonald, he has left the club a legend. He is beaten by only Brian Neo, Hugh Russell, Tug Wilson, Tony Cascarino, Brian Gibbs, Steve Lovell, Damian Richardson and Ken Price. And out of those players, Brian Neo, Tony Cascarino, Brian Gibbs, our very own Steve Lovell have a better goals to game ratio. And of course, Hugh Russell and Tug Wilson as well do, but that was in the regional league rather than the football league as we know it today, so those stats are slightly misleading. 81 goals in 223 games for Gillingham, which at this level is excellent in League 2 and League 1. That's 0.363 goals per game, which, end of the day, I know it's not necessarily the most clinical, but at the end of the day, he's going to get you goals at this level, which is so important. I mean, 12 goals last season. People said he had a bad season, and I myself was very critical of him at times, but 12 goals. Reece said in the last Sports Blog podcast, if he takes penalties, that's another, say, 4 or 5 on top of that, and that's easily a brilliant, brilliant return, especially playing a struggling team, especially playing as a new role, as McDonald said, which I think, you know, it's hard to let him go because do the club sort of expect to replace him with a striker that much for free? I'm not sure that you're going to get anyone for free with that sort of ability. McDonald's stats in League One at this level, you know, 52 goals in 173 games. It's 13 a season on average. Looking at the club at the minute, the four strikers you've got, Tom Eaves, Josh Parker, Nolan Byron, Greg Condell. I mean, and Byron Condell, both really, really still coming up from the youth team. I mean, I know Condell's not exactly just coming up from the youth team. He's been out on loan, but, you know, he's not had many minutes in a Gillingham shirt. And Bo's had 9 of the first team. Parker, I don't think he's going to be our first choice striker. And Tom Eaves just been released by Yeovil. And I don't think he's there for the goals, more for the link-up play, which would have been excellent with McDonald. But there we go. That's in the past. We move on. Looking at those four strikers, I think you're going to at least want to bring one more in. I mean, I know we didn't get the lad that went to Northampton, but you're going to want to look at a McDonald-type striker because Bo and Condell, sort of youth players, are going to be edged in. Eaves, the target man. Parker, the, you know, backup pace player that has proven himself such a sign of a 2-year deal. But you want the players going to guarantee goals, which makes me wonder why we didn't give McDonald the deal he needed. You know, another 2 years of 12 goals a season, maybe even more. Matt said in his video, Jules in the Blood, that, you know, if you keep him fit, play him in a good system, which it looks like we're going to do, play him with a target man, which we were planning to do with Tom Eaves. That's 15 goals at least, and I couldn't agree more. Definitely 15 goals at least this season. I don't see where we're going to get another player for that quality. I mean, I know McDonald's older, but are we going to get a player for free that scores that many goals? No, we're not. So yeah, that's very, very questionable. But you never know. It could depend on the replacement. We looked with JJ Hooper, been released by Port Vale. I mean, obviously he's scored a few goals at this level, but I think it's 13 goals in 51 games for Port Vale. But that's not, you know, proven as McDonald when there was definitely options to sign McDonald, which we should have done, you know. I myself, obviously, a general season ticket holder, I've been very critical of Cody McDonald. I mean, there's games where he wouldn't hardly touch the ball, he'll jump too early for headers. I mean, he'll run, he hasn't always had the best finishing. I know Jim has been critical of him. A lot of, I think it's fair to say, older generation players have been critical of him. But I think it's a situation maybe that you don't know what you've got until you've lost him. I mean, if we don't bring another striker in and we're struggling for goals next year, we're going to be missing McDonald like crazy. Now, those 13 goals have got to be replaced. His passion in the dressing room has got to be replaced. Quite frankly, I don't necessarily see how that's going to be replaced. It does, of course, depend on the replacements. I mean, someone like a John Marquise could walk in and just, obviously, I'm not saying John Marquise directly, but someone unproven could walk in and just set the club alight. I mean, he could be quicker, he could be younger, he could get the same roughly amount of goals, but that chance of happening for free are very, very, very slim. So, of course, it does depend on the replacement, but, you know, Cody McDonald, a club legend, I've met him. He's a very nice guy. He always there to take pictures of fans, his passion. I mean, and I've also always said Josh Wright should be captain, but McDonald, I've taken him as captain any day of the week in that Gillingham team. I mean, the fans loved him. I think it's just a shame to see him go, and I guarantee as well he's going to score against us. It's going to be hard to see him in another shirt. I mean, even seeing the pictures of him on Twitter in another shirt, it's just hard to see. But, you know, football, you move on. Older generation fans have seen club legends as well. For my generation specifically, it's just a shame to see him go. 9th full-time top goal scorer. It's just gutting because he thought he was going to his career journey. We could have had many more years here. It's just always a safe thing to have. McDonald in your squad, he's going to get your goals if he's fit. Playing the right system, 15 goals a season, and now you've got to try and replace that. But there we go, move on to this season and see how this season goes. Now we're going to go into your Twitter questions now, and the first question is from Sam Johnston, who sort of feeds into this question. His question is, why are we so obviously I've beat that out, so I'm going to change that to, why are we so crap? Obviously talk about Gillingham, Sam GFC Johnston on Twitter. Quite frankly, Sam, last year I think it's because of defensive situation. I mean, we were having to score at least 2 goals a game to win games, and it was just painful to watch at times, the defence. I'm cringing sitting here thinking about it now. I've spoken about it so many times, but the fact we didn't have a left back, Lee Martin's playing full back, he's playing wing back, he doesn't want to defend, the defenders are just awful, the setup was just horrible to watch. And I mean, it looks like we fixed that now with the signings of Alex Lacey, Zach Oani, Luke O'Neill, who all look really good signings. I mean, if we play a back four with O'Neill, Zakwani, Lacey and Garms next year, I'll be more than happy. I think we'll be quite solid defensively. Now it's looking like it's just the state of the club in the background. So many people said we're not going to move forward with Scally in charge. I can sort of see they're coming from in terms of job for the boys. I mean, there's always going to be stability with Scally financially. I mean, I know we're on a low budget, but I feel like there's always going to be stability, that we're not going to go back to how we were. Scally is buying the club for £1. I know there's been so many talks about the finances, but I feel like you can get a lot worse sort of thing. So you look at Leyton Orient, you look at Coventry, Blackpool, you can get a lot worse owners. But in terms of job for the boys, I sort of see it, because I've spoken about it before, but if Scally really had the best interests of the club at heart, I'm not sure he would have appointed Pennock, because I know that the speak of Pennock in the background is needed. He could have gone for a jacket. I mean, I know the budget necessarily wasn't great, but if he wanted to move the club forward really badly, we would have appointed a proven manager at this level and not appointed a man that nearly took us down last season, Sam. You've got to replace Dak's goals, you've got to replace McDonald's goals, you've got to replace Dak assists. I mean, Reece said in the last week's blog podcast recently that, you know, Wright isn't going to have that sort of season. You've got to replace Wright's goals. It just seems completely flipped at the minute that we're going to be struggling more attacking than defensively, but you know, I think in the background, a lot of the problems are. I mean, I'm hoping Pennant's got the bad eggs out he was talking about now, and we can sort of have a season of solidarity. But, you know, appointing the likes of Pennock, Lovell again, Taylor again, maybe not the best ideas from Scally. I mean, I know Peter Taylor. I'm a big fan of him as director of football, but, you know, it's the fact of always going back to who you know, your friends, that sort of thing. It's just not a nice thing to see. And I'm just hoping we can avoid relegation this season, but, you know, we'll see where that goes. But enough of me blabbing on about Gillingham, because it's a bit of a negative subject, especially kind of with leaving. Going to be going on to the next question from Lewis Hart. Now, obviously, it was on the podcast last time round. He asks, who is going to be the first manager in the Premier League to be sacked? Now, off the top of my head, you're looking at clubs that came up. You associate with who would be at the bottom. Brighton, you know, Chris Houston's done a brilliant job there. I can't see him being sacked. I can't see Wagner being sacked because of the stuff he's done at Huddersfield. Rafa Benitez, you know, maybe not necessarily sacked, but he's had some problems at Newcastle. I know he's much not bigger than the club, but, you know, he's a better manager than what Newcastle are. I mean, I'm hoping he's going to bring him forward. I know he's fallen out of Mike Ashley on occasions. Is he going to leave by mutual consent? Is he going to quit? You're looking at the likes of the teams that just avoided relegation. I mean, Frank de Boer, he struggled at Inter for sure. You've got to see where that's going to go. Marco Silva's done well to go to Watford. Pellegrino, you've got to see how he's going to do at Southampton as well. Mark Hughes at Stoke, I mean, he's always going to be solid at Stoke. They're never going to be in any trouble of getting relegated. But, you know, the players they had last season, the owner's going to sort of endure that boring, I'm going to brand it, consistency for that much longer. Feels like Stoke have got a lot of potential. It's probably getting quite boring for the fans. So maybe they want to make the step up. You never know. But, yeah, I'm going to go with Mark Hughes, because I think a lot of the clubs lower down are on the up. I mean, Watford have just got a good appointment in Marco Silva. I mean, the promoted clubs have all got very good managers in charge. Look at Palace and Swansea, who just stayed up last season. I mean, De Boer, obviously, I mentioned. Paul Clement's doing good things at Swansea, so my pick for that, Lewis, is Mark Hughes. The final question comes in from Lee Clifton. He says, What are my thoughts on the Premier League and Championship B teams being allowed to continue to participate in the Checker Trade Trophy? In a word, Lee, I'm going to say it's ridiculous because Johnson's Paint Trophy was brilliant, League 1, League 2, and those sort of teams were very good to watch. I mean, it was always good and people actually took the competition seriously. Now, Gillingham got to the regional finals, I mean, lost to Bristol City of a trophy, and it was very good and it was well respected by fans, by clubs, because it sort of gave the League 1 and League 2 teams a chance to win it. Now, I know Coventry won it this season, but I just think it's unnecessary because a lot of clubs have declined it. Gillingham went to West Brom last season and they took a like ridiculous short amount of away, like low amount of away fans. I mean, it's a competition for the lower league clubs, if you like. It gives them a chance to win something. It's pointless. It doesn't really help the Premier League teams develop players. I mean, look at Stoke last season. They're playing the likes of Peter Crouch, Charlie Adam in it. I mean, this is a B team, not an A team. It's a youth team. It's not a first team. I mean, clubs take it less seriously. And I mean, I went to the Gillingham game against Luton that they lost and they played a 15-year-old. I mean, is that serious? I'm 18 and someone 3 years younger is playing in that competition. I mean, there's a massive boycott about it. It's not respected by managers. Managers are taking the fines and the bans or whatever they throw at them on the chin because they don't care about the competition. I mean, last season, Gillingham went out in the group stage. Fans were happy they were out. I mean, they saw it as a waste of time. Players playing games that aren't needed because the Premier League teams aren't welcome, basically. Premier League teams aren't and Championship teams aren't welcome into the competition because it's a League 1, League 2 competition. And for some reason, it was voted to stay, but the same thing is going to continue next season, Lee. People are going to keep boycotting games. It's going to be ridiculous. I obviously want to watch my team play every given opportunity, so I went to Luton game in particular, and the atmosphere is horrible. I mean, I know it wasn't the best at the Johnson's Paint Trophy, but it's just a well-respected competition. Checker Trade Trophy's got so much more hate. It's just a shame to see the sort of Premier League teams being involved in lower league competition. Not really welcome. It gives the lower league teams a chance to win it. It's just a shame to see the Premier League Championship teams involved in that competition because they don't necessarily take it seriously. It's a competition for the League 1 and League 2 teams. Yeah, it's going to continue next season. We'll see how it goes, but I can't see it getting any better. It's a shame. Clubs aren't going to take it seriously. Fans are going to value it. It's just basically seen as a pointless competition, but there you go. That basically sums up the podcast for today's episode. I hope you enjoyed it. I tried to do my best whilst I was on my own. We're going to have a lot more videos coming this summer because exams are done. Woo. Please follow the Twitter accounts in the description below. Follow me, Ibs Jack, on Twitter. Check out Jim's work as well, graphic designer. Check out White Lines F1, which is Ibs' channel. There's also an advertisement out on the White Lines Media Facebook and Twitter pages that, you know, sort of talk about getting involved in the channel. Give me a message. Follow that. Those accounts as well, like the pages, just the one, but yeah, like the page. Please like, subscribe. Thank you, 150 subscribers. It's really nice to appreciate people what we're doing. I hope you enjoyed. Please like, subscribe. Thank you, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.